everyone. This is Nina Collins from Revel. This is our weekly, our monthly recording. One of my favorite things that we do every month, which is that the third Wednesday of every month, I get to have a conversation with Dr. Debbie Magids, who's a very excellent therapist based in New York City. And we do this in a webinar format so that members who are attending can ask questions in the chat or even raise their hand and ask questions vocally, which will get recorded. And then the event gets released as our podcast on Friday, as our Raging Gracefully podcast. And you can find that wherever you find podcasts. And I think that's it. For those of you who don't know, Revel is the social platform for women over 40, for women in midlife and beyond. We're a place where women can re-energize, reinvent themselves, find new things, find new friends, create events. And we're very happy to have you all here. So welcome, Debbie. Hi.
Hi. Thank you for having me.
So this week we're talking about how to not internalize stress, or what internalizing stress is about, how you know you're doing it. Made me think, like, my first question is, what's the difference between internalizing stress and externalizing stress? but basically, we want to talk about how to manage stress.
Yes. So I first want to start with two things that I want to at the top. First of all, if anyone's interested in sort of assessing their own stress, you can Google the Holmes and Rahe, H-O-L-M-E-S. And RAHE inventory. This is an old inventory from the 1960s, but it's still being used. And you can go online and take it for yourself to assess where you're at in your stress levels.
Wait, I want to do that. So hold on one sec. It's called the Holmes and Rahe.
Rahe, R-A-H-E
inventory.
H-O-L-M-E-S and Rahe, R-A-H-E inventory.
Okay.
And you can Google it online and sort of assess your own stress levels. When people do that, they'll see, and this is what I'm going to put out there, that everything in the world causes stress. So stress is inevitable, right? That's at the top of the list. Stress is inevitable because you're stressed if you're getting divorced, and you're stressed if you're getting married. You're stressed if you lost a home, and you're stressed if you're buying a new home. Like, everything creates some stress. So it's an inevitable part of life, and it needs to be understood as that. The second fact I want to put out there is splitting stress up into three different categories. To have no stress actually equals boredom and apathy and not living your life, right? Some people might say, I have no stress, but they're not doing that much in life, and it's not a great state to be in. The middle part is the good stress. We call it eustress, E-U-S-T-R-E-S-S, eustress.
Okay.
This is the stress that's necessary to feel alive, to feel motivated, to have peak performance. You know, so some stress is good for us. We need it to feel like we're really thriving in the world. What people talk about as stress is really distress. And that's the stress that creates anxiety, symptoms of anxiety, symptoms of depression, sleeplessness, physical ailments, headaches and back pain and gut issues. And, you know, that's the stress that people talk about as not good for us. So there's a line of like good for us, and then it can cross over into not good for us. And that's really what people are talking about when they say, I'm so stressed out.
This is kind of fabulous. I actually am totally learning something new. I'd never heard the word eustress. I just looked it up and put it in the chat.
I need to contribute something when I come to these webinars, right?
I'm totally like, this is like psych 101 for Nina today. And of course, distress, duh, distress, bad stress. All right. Well, so an example, I'm trying to think though of an example of good stress, because no stress actually feels good. You just mean more kind of thrumming along with busyness.
Well, I'm going on a TV appearance. I'm feeling a little stressed, but it's sort of excited stress, motivating stress. It gets you ready. It gets you motivated. It gets you, you know, prepared for the event you're about to have, where you're going to be a panelist somewhere, or you're going for a job interview, right? Like, you know, if we equate discomfort with bad, sometimes discomfort means we're excited about something, or something really means something to us, and it gets us sort of prepared and motivated to do what we need to do to perform, right?
Yeah. And as Sue in the audience says, going on vacation is good stress. I see what you mean.
Correct. you're excited, you're still stressed, you're not sleeping the night before, you got to get packed. Exactly. That's a great example.
Okay. So then let me ask though, because I've known a lot of really anxious people in my life. I can think of my most recent ex-husband, for example, for whom going on vacation was super stressful, and he would behave like a complete asshole. He would get like really angry before he traveled.
That's the line between what's useful stress and when does it topple over into I'm filled with anxiety, I'm filled with worry, I'm depressed, I can't sleep. You know, there is anyone who's listening, you can parse out where you're not feeling comfortable, but it's for good reasons, versus you cross over that line of I'm not feeling comfortable and now I feel not physically or mentally well. And that really is the distinction. You know, if we're excited about a vacation, the majority of us are feeling physically and mentally well. We're just, you know, churned up a bit.
I see. That actually is really helpful, because when I looked up in preparation for this, and I just looked up, you know, internalizing stress to kind of think about it, right? And the signs, the physical signs that you're internalizing stress were listed as digestive issues, yes, flaring temper, physical tension in your body, chronic fatigue, no sex drive, immunity failures, indulging in too many vices, and headaches. And I was thinking, okay, how many of those things? And I thought, okay, like I sometimes drink a little too much. Lately I feel a lot of tension in my shoulders. Mm-hmm. So like, I often feel like I'm hunched over. I feel like that's where I'm internalizing my stress. Mm-hmm. So I think right this minute, I'm not that successful right now in like only having good stress. So I want to, and I'm sure a lot of our listeners feel the same way.
And the symptoms you mentioned, and I had mentioned a few earlier, it's all sort of the mind-body connection, which is important to mention when we're talking about this stuff. And I will shout out to John Sarnow, who's now not alive, but Dr. Sarnow has all these books out on, it's called TMS, and how the body's emotional world wreaks havoc on the physical world. And it's really important that there isn't this interconnection of the mind body. And when stress is internalized, you're not dealing with certain emotional feelings and it will come out in physical ailments. And so that becomes very important.
Yeah. Wow. So I want you to talk a little bit more about that. Someone in the audience, Ronnie, just asked, would you say that the body cannot tell bad stress from good stress?
Give me one moment.
Yeah. It's a hard one.
Well, I'm going to say yes and no. And here's why. The body can't tell the difference. Stress is stress and it can wreak havoc. But the difference between good stress and bad stress is good stress, it sort of has an end point. Like you're gearing up for the vacation and then your body relaxes, or you're gearing up for the performance you're going to give, or you're gearing up for the job interview. When it becomes chronic is when the body and the mental health breaks down. So I guess, yes, you're right. The body can't tell, but what we do with it is different. And it's the chronic experience of the bad stress or the distress is what where the breakdowns happen.
Yeah. When you're not figuring out, which is kind of part of the point of what we wanted to talk about, is how do you manage to not internalize stress? So are you able to be successful at relieving your stress and moving on? Like, like normally I haven't felt in the last few years like my life is that stressful, but lately I've felt under a lot of stress because I'm working a lot. And I feel like I'm in this cycle of like, I can't do enough fast enough and I can't quite figure out how to get relief from it. And I'd love to hear from the audience if people have examples of how they're feeling stressful or want to talk. Oh, actually, Sandra would like to speak. So let's see if we can make this work and hear from Sandra. I'm clicking on her hand. See, this might be an example where the Zoom, it's not working. So okay. She's on an older Zoom. Judy would like to ask a question. Let's hear from Judy.
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Hey, thanks for hosting this. I've been to one before and I've really enjoyed it. Super helpful. So my big stress is I was recently downsized and kind of came out of nowhere. So I'm really free falling. Like, and it's the kind of thing where people are like, well, don't get stressed out, be kind to yourself. But then my fear is, if I take it too easy on myself, I'm not going to look for a job, because who wants to look for a job, right? So it's like that whole, and like speaking to Nina, like over the weekend, I said, I'm not going to think about looking for a job and, or not having a job. And I did that, and Saturday was wonderful. But then Sunday, it's like, here comes reality, you know? Mm-hmm. So yeah, I don't know how to manage it, honestly.
How is the stress manifesting for you in terms of symptoms, either mental health symptoms or physical symptoms? Has any of that hit you yet?
A lot of crying, a lot of bad sleep. Like I wake up in the middle of the night in the midst of like anxiety dreams and stuff. And also just like isolation. Like I live with my partner, but I don't want to reach out to friends because I think then it becomes, hey, what's going on with the job search? Like, did you find anything? You know, it's like that whole cycle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I get it. So here's the interesting part. And I don't know, Nina, if you want to jump in and say anything as well, but so let's talk about what to do with stress. And thank you for sharing, Judy, because I think you're not alone in that. You know, the number one thing I'm going to say that Judy's doing right, as far as I'm concerned, is you're actually feeling your feelings, right? Mm-hmm. You're crying it out. You're aware of the insecurity or the discomfort or feeling misunderstood or anger, whatever comes up for you when people ask you about it and you're not ready to talk about it. You're aware of the isolation. One of the number one things, Nina, that, and everyone listening, that comes up for people around stress, and Nina just talked to it, is you're so busy or you're so caught up in it that you're actually not aware of what the deeper emotional feelings are. And that's when it gets you. So if you heard everybody, Judy did not say my back hurts, my gut hurts. She's having anxiety dreams, which I'm not going to say is anxiety. That's actually fear, right? If we were to label the emotion, but she's not saying she's walking around feeling anxious. Those are all symptoms of not feeling. And if you're feeling, Judy, I will say, give yourself a little time to process through, because once you're done feeling, you'll actually be more ready to tackle what you need to tackle next. I actually think she's handling it well, because you can't just jump into action, because then you're missing the whole step of, I'm not supposed to feel good right now. I'm supposed to feel a little lost and rejected and pained. And if you go through that period, once you're done, you're actually going to feel replenished and have the tools and the emotional tools to go and look for the next job. I wouldn't rush it. I really wouldn't.
Yeah, I actually really agree with that. I think the point of sitting in how you're feeling makes a lot of sense. And actually it makes me wonder, because I've been physically, I don't usually physically feel manifestations of stress. Like, what am I not dealing with that my body feels so tight? Like I can just feel my shoulders all the time, kind of like this. So Judy, I think it's normal. I mean, that sucks to be downsized. Like that just sucks. Yeah,
it really does. And you're supposed to not feel good. And it's my number one lesson to everybody. I don't know why everyone thinks we're supposed to feel good all the time. Right. We're absolutely not supposed to feel good all the time. And rushing that process is what gets people into trouble.
Right? And I also loved how Judy said that she lives with her partner, but she's kind of staying away from her friends a little right now. Like that's really amazing that you recognize that. And I think recognizing it is really, in this case, certainly half the battle. Like you'll start coming back to your friends. Hopefully this conversation will help you be able to talk about it a little bit. I mean,
and also Judy, I don't know you, but you know, some of us, and I'm one of these people, I need to lick my wounds alone a little bit before I'm ready to sort of share it and let people in to give me their thoughts, because I can very easily feel misunderstood. And if someone says the wrong thing when I'm in the middle of a wound, it doesn't feel good to me. So we all have our process, and you honor that. I think it's okay to withdraw a little, feel, and then come out when you're ready. I'd love to know from Judy in a couple of weeks from now, but I promise you, I do believe you're going to be in a new space, because this is how you do it.
I think so too. You're processing it. You'll look for a new job, and you'll find a new job. Mm-hmm. All right, let's hear from VSN. Her name isn't quite. See, this just. Oh, now it works. Yes, great. Hi, you're on.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm not sure. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I switched over to my iPhone. I want to begin by saying hello to Dr. Debbie. Nice. And to you, Nina. It's a pleasure to meet you because I feel like I've known you a lifetime. I'm friends with Janet. She's the one who got me to sign up for Revel. I'm happy to be here. It's my first time.
Oh, so glad you're here. Welcome.
Yeah. Just to give you a little bit about me, my husband passed away quite suddenly and unexpectedly 12 years ago. And I am a widow with three, well, they were children, but now they're growing young men. And I feel like, although I'm in a better place with the grief and the acceptance, I'm just fine that I'm stressed all the time. Mm-hmm. I have what you call good stress. So now I understand how to separate the two, but I'm still full of the bad stress and I'm trying to sort of manage it. My biggest problems is I'm not sleeping well. So I'm waking up mm-hmm. with anxiety, but don't even know where it's coming from. So I'm hoping that today could shed a bit of light on helping me cope a little bit better. I have a great group of friends. I don't have a partner and I'm okay with that. I'm single and okay with that. At times I feel alone, but I'm never really alone. I'm more lonely. Mm-hmm. Reach out to friends. They're great support systems, but I have to find a better way to help myself. So that's why I'm here today.
Yeah. Thank you for sharing. And, you know, you're not alone. These are things that I think everyone's struggling with. And maybe we should start to talk about what we can do to get exactly. to, you know, regardless of where you're at with your stress or how it's manifesting for you, it's manifesting in sleepless nights more than anything else. So let me talk about three different parts to how you can address what's going on inside of you. And again, everyone is different, right? Like Judy is feeling her feelings. So part three of my solution, she's already doing. So I always work again. I'm always going to iceberg everything in my life. So there are cognitive behavioral techniques. And I put that at the top of the iceberg because they're the most clearly apparent things that you can do. In the middle, and Nina and I have talked about this, I talked to positive psychology tenets because those will be ongoing addressing distress in your life, ways you can combat it all the time so that it never gets to this point. And then there will be the deeper part of getting to the emotional feelings that a lot of people don't get to. So I'm going to start with the cognitive behavioral techniques. Nina, can you put the screen a little different? Because I'm staring at blankness.
Oh, you are? That's weird.
Yeah, that's better. Thank you. Because it's hard. I need to talk to a person so I can you know, feel good. So let's start with the cognitive behavioral techniques, right? These are the things that you can address in a very concrete way. So to start with, just because you feel things doesn't make them true, right? So if we're filled with fear, we're filled with anxiety, we have to take a beat and be like, I'm feeling something, but now I have to go to the data of my life. Is it true that I should feel afraid of money? Let's say a lot of people have money stress. Mm-hmm. Is it true that I should feel afraid that I'll never meet somebody, you know? And again, I'm talking to a broad audience. So whatever your thing is, I always want you to say to yourself, I'm feeling this, but what's the truth of my life? Let's go to the science. Let's go to the data.
Okay. Yeah. And let's just to help, cause this is so helpful. Feel free in the chat to write out your thing. Like I'm saying, in my case, does it matter that I have 400 unanswered emails? I'll get to them. Like, does it really matter?
Right.
Like, what you think is what's stressing you out?
What's stressing you out? And then you want to challenge it. So that's number one. Number two, I want everyone to keep in mind that feelings follow thoughts. And that's why this cognitive stuff is really important. If you change your thought, you will change how your body feels. And we use a technique that works, but people don't use it because they seem so simple and so stupid, but it actually works. It's called thought stopping. So when you're thinking something, if you are thinking something over and over, and you know what we tend to do when we're stressed or we have anxiety is we perseverate. We keep thinking about the same thing again and again and again. We can't help what thoughts come into our heads, but we can help what we do with them. Most people will indulge the thought. They'll keep going with it. But if you say stop, and shift your thought, you will shift how your body feels. I personally use this a lot as a shrink because I feel a lot of my clients' stuff. And if they hit on something that's personally sad for me and I could start crying at any minute, I'll shift my thought and get rid of the emotion right away. So very important that you can thought stop, because if you change your thought, you will change how you feel. The other part of this I want to talk to is that many people catastrophize things, right? That everything feels like a crisis, or they think everything's a crisis. And you have to remind yourself that literally, unless we're about to die, nothing's a crisis. Everything, there's always a new day. There's always the next hour. There's always a new choice. There will always be a solution, even though in the moment you might feel that the sky is falling or that you're going to be helpless forever. It isn't true. And that's when it's going to the data. But many people have this catastrophizing thing in them where in the moment it feels like the world is coming to an end, and it just isn't. And then there's always this age-old diaphragmatic breathing. And this works because it is a proven scientific method. If you breathe from the diaphragm, it slows your whole system down. And so whenever you feel in crisis, whenever you feel stress, even if you're in a panic attack, if you slow down your breathing, it will slow down your whole system. And so those are five techniques that in the moment, if you're feeling stressed, if anxiety starts to overtake you, if fear overtakes you, you can use them and they will help. They're not the end all be all solution to all life. Those are in the moment things that can help you right then and there.
No, but they really are great, great skills. I wish people would use the chat more and think about it, because it's like someone wrote midlife direction, overwhelm, finding my North Star. And I think many of us, if not all of us, can relate to that moment in life. I feel like I spent my 40s in that feeling of like, what am I doing with my life? Yeah. But it's true that if you just indulge it too much, like who is that serving? I kind of have to remind myself, it's kind of like what Debbie said, put one foot in front of the other when I'm having a, difficult, bad day, or, just kind of focus on just getting through the day. It's all okay. There's no crisis, as Debbie said.
Things are, and again, I'm going to say, like, if you're feeling badly and feeling sad, go with the feeling. I never want anyone to not go with the feeling, but once you get through the emotional piece, you then have to go back to shifting your thoughts and marching forward in life. Like, there's a system. And, when I talk about iceberging it, and I start at the top with cognitive behavioral, and at the bottom, I'm going to talk to meditation. These things are operating at the same time. It's not like a linear thing. Like, at times you're going to need the quick CBT thing. At times you're going to need to sit and meditate and get to your feelings. And at times, I'll talk about the middle one, but we have to sort of assess where we're at and what we need at what moment, but we want all the tools in the toolbox. We want the whole repertoire so that we can use what we need to use when we need to use it.
Yeah, I knew you'd get to meditation. I was worried. I was like, oh, she's going to tell us to meditate. And I just don't meditate. But I have to say, someone recently told me that a good thing to do when coping with stress is to set a timer on your phone and every hour on the hour to just breathe for a minute, the diaphragmatic breathing, which is akin to meditation, right? It's a mini meditation every hour.
So I want to do something with you very quickly. Because Nina and I have talked about meditation a lot, and I'm a big believer in it, mostly because it helps you access feelings. And like going back to Judy, because she was a great way to start this. If you're accessing your feelings, then you're 10,000 steps ahead of the game. Many people are not doing it. And then there's all the meditations. You can do the breathing every 10 minutes. You can do guided meditation. You could do transcendental meditation. But I like this thing, music to me really reaches your soul, and it can really help you feel. And there's this thing I did called music therapy. And I sat in a room for 45 minutes, and you sat with your eyes closed and music was just played, and you got in touch with what feelings came up. So I just want to play one song for you. I have it here. I hope you can all hear it. And I just for 1 minute, listen to it. And I want everyone to see what feelings come up for you. Okay.
Okay. Awesome. I'm going to close my eyes. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, it's a good point. I found that very soothing.
Yes. For me, sadness comes up immediately. I could cry every time I hear this song, right?
Really?
Every time. And for everyone listening, it's going to conjure up something. It may be different for all of us. You know, I have another song I play that every time I hear it, I'm instantaneously happy. Doesn't matter what mood I'm in. So music has a powerful influence over our emotions. So if you don't want to sit and meditate 20 minutes twice a day, you can try this. I also talked to cinema therapy, right? I'm going to put a shout out here. I watched the movie Coda the other night. First movie in I can't remember how many years that I just cried my eyes out. It touched me so deeply. When we watch movies or shows or commercials, when we feel something, it's information about self. Sometimes it's easier to cry for somebody else or something mm-hmm. you see on the screen, but we don't cry for no reason. It's information about ourselves. It's hitting something inside of us. So anytime you're feeling stressed or symptoms of anxiety or depression or anything, but today we're talking about stress, try to relieve your emotions. You know, it could be through music. It could be through watching something. Some of us think of a movie or a show that every time we see it, you cry, go put that on. But it helps you release because it's super important not, it's like we get stuffed up and then things break down. No different than a sink or a toilet or a car, right? You cannot get stuffed up. And in the human beings, the stuffing up is emotions, mm-hmm. period, the end. So there are different ways. There's more than one way in. Some people through therapy, they feel, I've got clients, you know, with me for a lifetime. I have never yet to see them cry. It's like, oh my God, right? But people run differently. So we try to find other ways to reach the depths of who we are.
Yeah.
I don't know if you have something to say.
Remind me of the name of that song. It's Sound Patrol or someone?
No Patrol, Chasing Cars.
No Patrol, Chasing Cars.
I can spend the whole time just playing songs for you that I feel something for, but.
You know what we should do? We should get a Debbie playlist. That'd be awesome. I want to address one of the questions here because I think this is a little different than what we're talking about. Someone says, what do you do when a scary thought or scene from a movie or a book recurs and recurs as if real, despite thought stop for a moment? I feel like that's anxiety and not really stress, right?
Yeah. And there's something got hit deep that's deeper. You know, the hard part of these seminars sometimes is that we talk in general, right? And that's even with therapy, right? There are general things that we all know, but then there's nuances to everybody's life, everyone's internal world, everyone's emotional makeup based from childhood. And so you really have to try to take sort of the themes that we're talking about and then apply them to the nuances of your life. This does sound like something very fear-based that's inside whoever asked this. Yeah. It got triggered. So there's something deeper that got triggered there. Cause that is beyond like, I'm feeling stressed and I have to shift my thoughts. So I feel something different. So I would look into what got tapped there that you probably haven't addressed. And it's always from childhood. Sorry.
No, I agree. Mm-hmm. All right. So I want to just kind of recap a few things. First of all, there's good stress and there's bad stress, right? There's eustress and distress.
Yeah.
I still didn't get the answer of when we internalize stress versus, I guess when we externalize stress, we just act out in really bad ways, right? We beat people up. We curse at people.
Well, some do, not all of us. I really think the question is if you've internalized it, meaning it's impacting your mental and physical health versus releasing it. I don't know that it's
definitely. Oh, I see. That makes sense. Okay.
Yeah, like some people will exercise and release their stress and not end up with body pains and anxiety or you know, things like that.
Got it. That's a good clarification.
That's my definition.
Anyway. Yeah, no, that makes a lot of sense. So internalizing stress is when it's really affecting our bodies.
Yeah.
And then what we talked about in terms of how you can address it, there are cognitive behavioral ideas around controlling your thoughts, not catastrophizing. Mm-hmm. There's meditation.
Getting to your inner feelings. And the middle part, which we're not going to have time to go through all here, but you and I have talked about it. I talk about this middle part of the tenets of positive psychology because I find that these principles sort of combat distress. Like if you put some of these principles into your life, like as part of your life, then you will be less likely to reach distress. And I'll read them off. You guys can look into it. We can have another talk about it, but you can look up the book Flourish. All of a sudden his name just popped out of my head. Who's the father of positive psychology?
Oh, the guy who has the program.
Oh my God. This is my aging. I'm going to tell you right now. That's so stupid.
It's no, it's not stupid, Debbie. It's Martin Seligman.
Thank you. I've lived for this man my whole life. I've seen him a million times. Martin Seligman. So he talks about optimism versus pessimism. I'm just going to say one thing about this, that I think optimism is one of the most important tenets of life. Some people were born with looking at what you've got versus what's missing. Most people are always focused on what they're missing versus what they've got. If you don't have it naturally, you want to cultivate it. There's seeking pleasure in your life and humor, learning to give to others, forgiveness, gratitude, cultivating relationships, zest for work, flow, meaning and purpose, and interest and dreams. Those are the tenets. Each one of them, there's a lot to say about. But I would highly recommend, and we can do a whole session on this if people want, if you put some of those things, if you're cultivating gratitude every day, if your life is filled with purpose and meaning, and you're giving to others, if you are seeking things that bring you joy and you're optimistic, you're less likely to ever get to the point of distress. Mm. It's not proof positive, but you know, if you think about, like, if you have these cognitive behavioral techniques, if you are practicing some of the tenets of positive psychology on a daily basis, if you're exercising on a daily basis, if you are getting in touch with your feelings on at least a weekly basis, you're mm-hmm. less likely to get stuffed up and end up in distress where it's affecting mental and physical health.
That's so can I ask you about getting in touch with your feelings on a weekly basis? What does that actually look like? Does that mean like writing in a journal, talking to a therapist?
It's different for everybody. You know, so for instance, I cry out my feelings every day, except for Monday and Tuesday. I tend to not cry out my feelings.
You cry every day, except for Monday and Tuesday?
Almost every day, right? So like I do this for a living. I take in a lot of people's emotions. If I didn't release, I not only would have my own emotions, I would have everybody else's emotions stuffing up my system. But I can get in touch with my emotions really easily. But sometimes it will come unexpectedly. I can just sit and just be quiet and emotions will flow. But like I watched Coda the other night. I didn't expect to cry. Cried my eyes out.
Everyone said Coda was so good, but I watched half an hour and I was bored. What's wrong with me?
It doesn't touch you.
It just didn't touch you.
Or you're distanced from something that touches you too much. I don't know. Hmm. I don't know. But I'm sure there are things, you know, you have to, some people journal and cry. Some people talk to a therapist and cry. Some people, you know, and you know, this music therapy that I told you about, like, make a playlist of the songs that touch you. And if you feel like you're stuffed up, listen to that playlist. You know,
are you saying that we have to cry every week? Because I don't cry anymore really very much. I used to cry all the time. I think I cried every day in my 20s and 30s practically.
I'm saying that if you can cry and release your emotions, it's super helpful. I'm not saying you have to cry, you know, and also there's crying and this crying, right? So the crying you did in your 20s and 30s, a lot of people cry because they're going through a breakup or something really, like someone died, versus getting in touch with our humanness. You know, if we're feeling 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, we're just not in touch with it all the time, nor should we be. Mm-hmm. But if one is paying attention, there are things that touch us all the time. You know, for me, seeing animals suffer or seeing the homeless or watching what's happening in Ukraine, like there are things in the world that are out of our one little world that are painful. The world is filled with pain and helplessness and suffering. And so being able to feel what's going on for you and releasing it, super helpful. Some people aren't going to cry, but they're going to get it out during a workout or experience something in a meditation. But yeah, to me, that's the most helpful, healthy thing you can do.
Yeah. Ooh. That's interesting. Yeah.
Maybe the whole world's distracting themselves. They don't want to feel a thing. People think they're not supposed to feel bad. And you know, all the addictions of everyday life. And my thing is, you are supposed to feel sad sometimes, because life is sad sometimes, and helpless and crazy making and angering. Like, just feel.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Well, that's our takeaway on internalizing stress. Feel more and meditate and don't catastrophize. So on the one hand, you have to feel more, but on the other hand, you have to realize that it's not the end of the world. It's challenging.
Feelings is not crisis. Feelings is emotion. I'm going to say one more thing. I'll let you end your podcast. If you haven't seen it, go see the kids' movie Inside Out, because it explains emotions really well. And just very briefly, the story is about Joy and Happy wanting to get rid of all the other emotions, especially sad. She didn't think that there was any reason for sad. Sad gets lost. The whole system breaks down. Culminates in Joy realizes you can't have joy without sad, right? And all the, and resentment and anger and all the jealousy and everything in between. It's a really cute portrayal of the importance of emotions and that they all count, not just the happy, joyful one.
All right. Well, Laura in the audience says she didn't like that movie. It bugged her, but Angie said it's a good movie. So I don't think I've even heard of it.
It's a children's movie. It's not the most exhilarating movie, but it has a really good message.
Yeah. Well, this session is making me question. I always think I'm so in touch with my feelings, but I'm kind of questioning that a teeny bit right now. Maybe I am like squashing some stuff and.
Oh, definitely. Oh. Yeah. Yeah. You're an aware human, but you certainly have the capacity to not feel everything all the time.
Right.
I think I know you well.
You know me well. You know me well.
Yeah.
Cry from happiness. So someone's talking about The Notebook. Haven't seen it in years, but cry every time I do see it. It does touch me personally. Yeah, I mean, that's a good point. I actually avoid movies that make me cry. Like Beaches used to just make me cry so much. Like, I don't want to watch that. Like, ugh.
Right. But if you're ever feeling stuffed up, that would be a good way to help you release.
Okay. So one more question then. How do you know you're feeling stuffed up? Because you're having all these bodily effects of stress.
Your neck is hurting, or your head is hurting, or you're anxious all the time, or you're worrying all the time. I also want to just put the caveat out. People that worry, you have to talk to yourself. Worry is the biggest waste of time, because the things that we're worrying about 99% of the time are not the things that happen in life, right? The things that any of us have actually suffered through, we weren't waiting for it to happen. They just sort of showed up. And the things that we worry about typically don't show up. So
completely true. Dawn's in the audience. And says, when I get super bottled up, I cry after sex. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's an emotional place.
And then Melissa M is asking for a list of movies we can watch when we need to cry. That's a really good idea, Melissa. I'm going to try and get Debbie to give us her playlist, which we can publish on Revel, a music playlist. And I'm also going to work on a movies to make you cry list.
Yeah, I have a whole bunch of them I can share. I used to tell clients to watch, like if I watch This Is Us and an episode I found extreme, I'm like, you have to watch this episode and I need to hear what you felt. You know, I would always assign things as I watch them, and I would suggest to my clients that they watch them. And it was helpful.
All right. Well, let's do that. Debbie, can I ask you to do a little work and start sending me some lists, and then we'll put it together in some cute pieces of content. I think that would be really useful.
Okay. I would be happy. do some work for you.
And we will definitely do an episode on the tenets of happiness. I'm going to order Flourish. I haven't read it. And I love Seligman also. So yeah. We'll definitely do that. And once again, I can't remember what our subject is next month. I say that every time, but we will be here next month on the third Wednesday at 3 p.m. Eastern. Yeah. And thank you to all our lovely members for participating. Really appreciate it. Yeah.